So students, how are you doing? I hope you are fighting to crack next. And in that adventure to crack ENT, I am with you. We saw in the last lecture ki kaise anatomy of pharynx hai, pharynx ke three parts hai, nasopharynx, oropharynx and laryngopharynx, the applied aspects of its anatomy. But what were the important crux points? Let's quickly take 5 seconds and revise. Important points. Number one, the entire pharyngeal tube is how much? 12 centimeters, right? Number two, what is the important lining epithelium? The squamo-columnar junction. So if you don't forget this, you will remember that there is columnar epithelium in the nasopharynx, squamous epithelium in the oropharynx and laryngopharynx. Yes, so you remember that. You also remember in the nasopharynx, two important things. One, eustachian tube opening followed by torus tuberus and fossa of Rosenmüller behind it. Yes, and also tubal tonsils behind the eustachian tube. Right. The other important thing, the skull base. The skull base has got what? The skull base has got adenoids in the children. And it is also the starting point of the notochord. And therefore, there is the remnant of notochord that is called as the Rathke's pouch, or where you develop the Thonwald cyst. Oropharynx. Oropharynx, two things I asked you to remember. One was the muscles of the oropharynx. If you remember the muscles of the oropharynx, there was a uvulae, there was a tensor villi palatini, levator villi palatini, palatoglossus and palatopharyngeus. These were the muscles of the pharynx. The nerve supply of the muscles of pharynx. All muscles are supplied by the 10th nerve except tensor villi palatini, which is supplied by the 5th nerve. Right. The other thing I asked you to remember about the oropharynx, that is the tonsils. All right. Tonsils. Tonsils are nothing but lymphoid organs. And there are two tonsils. In front of it, there is lingual tonsil. Behind that, there is tubal tonsil. Behind that, there are adenoids. This forms a circle, and this circle of Avengers, we called it as Waldeyer's ring. Which Waldeyer's ring? The inner Waldeyer's ring. Remember that. Don't forget inner Waldeyer's ring. That is the circle of immunity, which involves the adenoids, the tubal tonsils, the palatine tonsils, and the lingual tonsils. Remember. Then the hypopharynx, three parts of hypopharynx. There are the piriform fossa, right? And then there is post-cricoid region and there is posterior pharyngeal wall. So only three structures forming the piriform fossa. Most common malignancy of the pharynx is squamous cell carcinoma. Wonderful. Muscles of pharynx, two types, constrictors and longitudinal muscles. Three constrictors, superior, middle, inferior, longitudinal. Three, palatoglossus, styloglossus, salpingoglossus, all of them supplied by the vagus nerve except the stylopharyngeus, which is supplied by the 9th nerve, which is the glossopharyngeal nerve. Excellent. So now we have revised the anatomy. And I left you with one question. Aapko yaad hai maine aapko kis slide ke saath chhoda tha? I remember. So let's go to that slide. I left you with this diagram in the last lecture. This diagram was of the inferior constrictor. We remember inferior constrictor. Inferior constrictor was taking its origin from the thyroid cartilage and the cricoid cartilage and going into the pharyngeal aponeurosis and forming the inferior constrictor, right? Inferior constrictor. Inferior constrictor had two parts, the thyropharyngeus and the cricopharyngeus. So this is the thyropharyngeus and cricopharyngeus once we look at it from behind. And I told you that these muscles are forming a network. And between the thyropharyngeus and the cricopharyngeus, there is a small gap, the small triangular fossa. And this small triangular fossa is called as Killian's dehiscence or Killian's dehiscence. And this Killian's dehiscence is a small gap. When there is a small gap, no muscle around it, what will happen when you, if you are having a neuromuscular disorder, or if you're an old patient where there is incoordination between the contraction of muscles, or you've gulped in a large amount of food, peristaltic wave is very strong, what will happen? The mucosa will outpouch from this. So, hamari jo pharynx ki mucosa hai, that is going to outpouch from here. So let's see what is going to outpouch. Let us just cut this and understand this with a better diagram, right? So if you remember, this was the skull base, this were the vertebrae, right? This was the nose, this was the oropharynx, and this is the pharyngeal wall going behind. And this is the larynx. This is the laryngopharynx. So what happens is when the bolus of the food comes inside, it gives a pressure on the posterior pharyngeal wall. And from this Killian's dehiscence, this mucosa outpouches, right? And it forms what is called as a diverticulum. Ek diversion ban jata hai, temporary diversion. And this diverticulum is what we call this as the Zenker's diverticulum. What we call this as Zenker's diverticulum. Let's go and have a better look into this Zenker's diverticulum. So this is a diagram which is showing you from the lateral aspect and from the posterior aspect. What is the lateral aspect showing you? The exactly what we studied right now, that the pharyngeal mucosa is showing an outpouching into the posterior pharyngeal, into the retropharyngeal space. And that is when we look at it from behind, we see a outpouching coming behind, and that was discovered by Zenker, and it is called as Zenker's diverticulum. It is called Zenker's diverticulum. Now, if I ask you, how will this patient present to you with? What will, it's very obvious, you know, anybody can looking, if you know this diagram, you will always be able to answer. What will this patient present to you with? Simple, no, the food is going to get lodged in this area. So there will be retainment of food. This patient is going to have dysphagia, right? This patient is going to have foul smell. There is going to be halitosis, foul smell. That is why he is going to have, because the food is going to stay there for a long time. Food and water is going to get locked there. So wahan pe jab khana bahut der tak pada rahega, it is going to create a foul smell. The patient khud bhi apni buri smell aayegi aur dusron se baat karega, wo bhi usko kahenge ki bhaiya bahut buri smell aa rahi hai, right? Then another thing this patient is going to have is a swelling, right? Where is this swelling going to come out from? Now, let us just understand, if I rub this much, ye hamara kya hai? Diverticulum piche ja raha hai. Lekin piche kya hai? Piche hai hamara vertebrae. Vertebrae are not going to get pushed out. So, what will happen? Jab ye diverticulum piche se nikalne ki koshish karega, us time par hamara jo vertebrae hai, wo usko piche nahi jane dega. So it will find a space outside and is going to come out in the neck somewhere here, right? So there is going to be a swelling, but this swelling is going to be in the lateral part of the neck, a little posteriorly, but sometimes it is also called posterolateral swelling. But samajhne ki baat kya hai, na to ye aage aa raha hai kyunki aage larynx ne isko rok rakha hai aur piche vertebra ne isko pakad rakha hai, to vertebra isko jagah nahi degi piche grow karne ke. So this pouch will come out from the side. So this is a differential diagnosis for a lateral neck swelling. So lateral neck swelling, one of the causes is Zenker's diverticulum. So the swelling will be in the lateral part of the neck, right? Very occasionally there is pain also. So these are the common symptoms that the patient is going to come to you with. Now, how will you examine? Aapne neck swelling dekha, to kyunki ye mucosal swelling, it is going to be a soft cystic kind of swelling. Aur kyunki iske andar mein khana bhara hua hai, so when you will press it, or maybe when you will auscultate it, you will hear gurgling sounds, a gad 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 awaaz aayegi. Kyun? Kyunki uske andar mein khana aur pani dono bhara hua hai. So that particular sign is called as Boyce's sign. What is it called as? Boyce's sign. What is Boyce's sign? Boyce's sign is the gurgling sound when you get in the lateral neck swelling, when you compress it or when you hear it with auscultation, right? So that is Boyce's sign. Now, if it stays for a very long time, then can it cause malignancy? Yes, it can, but the transformation rate is very, very slow. So there is a potential for malignancy, but very less chances. किन लोगों में ये ज्यादा होता है? ओल्ड एज लोगों में ज्यादा होता है, और उन लोगों में ज्यादा होता है जिनके अंदर में न्यूरोमस्कुलर डिसऑर्डर्स हो, क्योंकि वो अपना कोऑर्डिनेशन नहीं कर पाते हैं, वीक मसल्स हो, वीक पेरिस्टाल्सिस हो, उन लोगों के अंदर में ये काफी कॉमन डिजीज है, राइट? हाउ विल यू इन्वेस्टिगेट? हाउ विल यू डू इन्वेस्टिगेशन? इफ यू लुक एट इट बाय एंडोस्कोपी, तो अगर हम यहां से अपना एक एंडोस्कोप डाल के देखेंगे तो हमें डाइवर्टिकुलम दिखेगा. व्हाट वी विल सी इन द एंडोस्कोप? वी विल सी अ नॉर्मल गोइंग फैरिंग्स एंड देन वी विल सी अ डाइवर्टिकुलम हियर. सो लेट अस सी द फोटोग्राफ. एंड यू कैन ऑल्सो डू वन मोर टेस्ट, दैट इज सीटी स्कैन. बट सीटी स्कैन समटाइम्स, ऑफकोर्स इट इज अ वेरी गुड टेस्ट, सीटी स्कैन एंड एमआरआई, but it will not delineate the track very well. So agar humko track ko delineate karna hai to hum kya karenge, hum is patient ko ek kuch dye pilayenge, right? Aur dye pilane ke baad mein hum us patient ko kahenge ki ab aapka ek x-ray kar lete hain. So when you will do the dye and you will take an x-ray, Wow, what a wonderful diagram you can see. You will see, be able to see a nice diverticulum over here, right? So that is called as the right, that is the Zenker's diverticulum. So the investigation of choice barium swallow. So you will give the dye barium to the patient and take an x-ray. That is the investigation of choice. How will you treat this patient? Does he require medical treatment? No, this is a surgical diverticulum and you need to remove it surgically. There are a lot of procedures available. You can do endoscopic stapling. So let us see how you look at it endoscopically. So when you look at it, see, this is the normal pharynx and the diverticulum, and this is the in-between septum. Right? So this is the diverticulum, this is the normal lumen of the esophagus, I mean the pharynx going into the esophagus. So you can do stapling of this, you can remove it by staplers, endoscopic stapling, or you can use diathermy. Diathermy is by burning out this area so that it becomes one pouch. So let us say if this is the diverticulum, so you will burn out this much area so that this becomes one cavity again, right? So that is called as diathermy. This diathermy is one of the common procedures that is done and was given by Dolman. Dolman is a surgeon who did amazing work on pharyngeal diverticulums. Lots of paper published by him. If ever you get time, postgraduate students, if you are watching my video, please go and have a look at his papers. Amazing presentation on the pharyngeal diverticulums. Of course, if you cannot do endoscopic diathermy, or the diverticulum is too big, or there is a, if you are suspecting or biopsy shows a malignant transformation, then go for an open surgery, right? So what have we learned about the Zenker's diverticulum? That one, it is a diverticulum which is arising from the cricopharynx and the thyropharynx, the cricopharyngeus and the thyropharyngeus, which is a part of the inferior constrictor. Where is the swelling going to be? It is going to be in the lateral part of neck. What is this going to patient going to present with? He's going to present with halitosis and dysphagia. And how is this patient going to be investigated? The investigation of choice is going to be barium swallow, right? Now we have done this disease from the hypopharynx. Let's go a little bit up into the oropharynx. We saw two important structures in the oropharynx, the palate and the tonsil. So let us see something about the tonsils now. Have you ever seen this kind of a photograph? I'm sure half of you must have had this condition yourself during your lifetime. What is this condition? Very obvious. This is a case of tonsillitis. Now this, let us see, this is the anterior pillar. Anterior pillar is formed by the palatoglossus. This is the uvula, uvulae. There, which muscle is there? Uvulae, right? Behind this, you can see the posterior pillar. Can you see this? I'll show you with another dye color. This is the posterior pillar going behind. So this is the posterior pillar. This is the posterior pillar, right? And here you can see the tonsils, which are enlarged, and this tonsil is red and congested and is showing even pus over it. This is a case of acute tonsillitis. Now, acute tonsillitis and chronic tonsillitis are two very important concepts that you should understand. What are the differences between acute and chronic? How will they present to you, and how you should be able to manage them? Acute is of course the time limit, the duration that we divide it is of course the time limit. That something that is happening in less than 3 to 6 weeks is acute, and something that is happening for more than 6 weeks is chronic, right? So that is the broad classification, clinical classification that we follow. Of course, some books will tell you more than 3 months and up, but then nobody is going to stay with tonsillitis for 3 months. You will visit a doctor, you will take some antibiotics. So, isliye hum clinically ye mante hain ki bhai agar aapka within 3 to 6 weeks hi agar aapka infection hua hai to usko hum acute kinenge, aur thoda long standing ek mahine se agar aapka gala kharab chal raha hai, we will consider this as a chronic tonsillitis, right? What is the other difference that we are going to have? We are going to see with acute and chronic tonsillitis. In acute tonsillitis, there are going to be tonsillitis, there is inflammation, and therefore there are going to be all the signs of inflammation. So there is going to be fever, there is going to be inflammation of the tonsils, they're going to be red, there could be even pus discharge from the tonsil, and the patient cannot eat. Hamare हमको जब टॉन्सिलाइटिस होता है तो हम खाना खा पाते हैं नहीं, इवन ड्रिंकिंग वाटर इज समटाइम्स वेरी वेरी पेनफुल. सो दिस काइंड ऑफ डिस्फेजिया इज कॉल्ड व्हाट? ओडाइनोफेजिया. दिस टाइप ऑफ डिस्फेजिया इज कॉल्ड पेनफुल स्वेलोइंग, सो दैट इज ओडाइनोफेजिया. What is the sensory nerve supply of the pharynx? The sensory nerve supply of the pharynx is the ninth nerve. Remember this. So the patient, ninth nerve is also supplying our ear. So patient is also going to have referred otalgia. So is patient ko saath saath mein kya hoga? Referred otalgia hoga, right? How about chronic tonsillitis? The chronic tonsillitis patient is going to have fever? No, it is chronic. Abhi ded mahine se chal raha hai. So this patient will have no fever. Will there be signs of acute inflammation of the tonsils? No, there will be no acute inflammation, right? But the tonsil size will be there, will be raised. So what we call this as, there is hypertrophy of the tonsils. There is hypertrophy of the tonsils. We will grade this. I will just show you how we grade this tonsillar hypertrophy. Will there be dysphagia? Yes, there will be dysphagia. Will there be painful swelling? No pain. This is not an acute condition. So there will be dysphagia. Sorry, there will be dysphagia, but there will be no pain, right? And how about odynophagia? No, there is no pain. How about referred otalgia? Again, because this is not an acute condition, there will be no referred otalgia in this condition. Then what will be there that will show us acute tonsil? Now, because this is a chronic condition, there is going to be the spread of infection along the lymphatics, or isiliye humko milega lymphadenopathy. We are going to get lymph nodes that are going to be enlarged. This is what we call as lymphadenopathy, right? So what are the cardinal signs of chronic tonsillitis? Let us look at this picture and we will understand it better. Three cardinal signs you cannot afford to forget. अगर ये तीन साइन होंगे तो क्रॉनिक टॉन्सिलाइटिस होगा ही होगा. व्हाट इज द फर्स्ट साइन? द फर्स्ट साइन इज दैट देयर इज गोइंग टू बी फ्लश्ड एंटीरियर पिलर. व्हाट इज फ्लश्ड एंटीरियर पिलर? ये नया वर्ड आ गया हमारे सामने, फ्लश्ड. फ्लशिंग मींस देयर इज, जब हम थोड़ा सा रेडिश टिंज आता है बट देयर आर नो साइंस ऑफ इन्फ्लेमेशन, राइट? सो देयर इज मिनिमल स्वेलिंग एंड रेडनेस बट देयर इज नो ऑब्वियस साइन ऑफ इन्फ्लेमेशन, right? So no pain is there. That is flushed anterior pillar. So can you see, this is the normal mucosa, but can you see the anterior pillar on the two sides? It is a little red, but this is not painful. So that is flushed anterior pillar. Second is the, can you see these white structures coming out? What are these white structures? This is a cheesy material. It looks like cheese, liquid cheese coming out. So when you press over the anterior pillar, the tonsils will show liquid, the cheesy material coming out. This cheesy material is the retained infection, retained food particles together with pus. Ek cheesy amalgam jaisa bana deta hai, which comes out. This is called as Irvin-Moore sign. Remember this sign. What is Irvin-Moore sign? Irvin-Moore sign is when you press over the tonsil, the cheesy material comes out from the crypts of the tonsil. And third is the lymphadenopathy, the jugulodigastric lymph nodes that are enlarged. That is the clinical sign of the tonsil. All right, have you understood this? Wonderful. Now, these are the signs. How will you decide whether this patient should go for surgery or should not go for surgery? For that, there has been, again, few people have given, there is a sign criteria, there is a paradise criteria. So different criterias are there. Let us try to understand कि ये सब क्या कहना चाह रहे हैं. अगर आपके पास में ऐसा कोई पेशेंट है जिसको बार बार इन्फेक्शंस हो रहे हैं, रिकरेंट इन्फेक्शंस हो रहे हैं, इतने इन्फेक्शंस हो रहे हैं कि साल में 3-4 बार उसको एंटीबायोटिक्स खानी पड़ रही है, then that will be a good candidate for surgery. So a patient who is showing these three signs positive, that will be a good patient for surgery. Patient who is not getting relieved by antibiotic therapy also, that will be a good patient for surgery. So can we try to note down these criteria? Can we try to make a chart where we can understand, okay, if these are the exact criteria, we will post this patient for surgery. So we follow the common paradise criteria for this. The paradise, what did the paradise say? One, symptoms ke basis par. What were the symptoms of the patient? So symptoms means how he is presenting to you with. So symptoms ke basis par usne aisa kaha tha ki if you are having a patient who is presenting to you with more than 7 episodes in last, let us say, 3 to 4 years. If he's presenting to you with 7 episodes in the last 1 year, or more than 5 episodes in last 2 years, or more than 3 episodes in 3 years. So that means, कहने का अर्थ क्या है कि recurrent episodes हो रहे हैं. So if he's having a recurrent tonsillitis, right? So recurrent tonsillitis is one indication for surgery. Signs. What are the signs that he will present with? So these 3 signs, remember, flushed anterior pillar, Irvin-Moer sign, and jugulodigastric lymph nodes. So if these signs are present, then it is called cardinal signs, and these cardinal signs are present, post the patient for surgery. Third, documented antibiotics. So documentation and antibiotics. What is documentation and antibiotics? Number one, Paradise said, एक तो आप जितनी बार डॉक्टर के पास जाए उसको डॉक्यूमेंट करा ले, या डॉक्यूमेंट नहीं भी कराए तो आपके डॉक्टर एक पर्टिकुलर फिजिशियन या सर्जन को आप फिक्स रखें और उसके पास में आपका पूरा रिकॉर्ड होना चाहिए कि हाँ, इस इंसान को लास्ट कपल ऑफ ईयर्स में या कपल ऑफ मंथ्स में इतने फ्रीक्वेंट इन्फेक्शन हुए थे, एंड फॉर विच एंटीबायोटिक्स वर गिवन, बट द पेशेंट इज नॉट गेटिंग रिलीव्ड. सो नो रिलीफ बाय एंटीबायोटिक्स. सो दैट इज अ क्लासिकल candidate for surgery. With surgery, tonsillectomy. So which antibiotics are we talking about? Let's see what is the treatment of acute versus chronic. So we have seen acute tonsillitis and chronic tonsillitis. What is the treatment of acute and chronic tonsillitis? For acute tonsillitis, of course, the treatment, kyunki wo acute stage mein hai, treatment is going to be antibiotics along with सपोर्टिव मैनेजमेंट. वॉट डू मीन बाई सपोर्टिव मैनेजमेंट? सपोर्टिव मैनेजमेंट में 3 चीजें बहुत जरूरी हैं. नंबर 1, डाइट. पेशेंट को क्या खाना है? ही शुड नॉट बी ईटिंग स्पाइसी फूड, ही शुड नॉट बी ईटिंग कोल्ड फूड. सो वो एक इंपॉर्टेंट चीज है. फ्लूइड्स. सो पेशेंट शुड आइदर बी, इफ ही इज एबल टू ड्रिंक ओरली, तो प्लेंटी ऑफ फ्लूइड शुड बी टेकन, अदरवाइज पेशेंट शुड बी पुट ऑन आईवी ड्रिप्स. एंड थर्ड, ड्रग्स. ड्रग्स में क्या है, जैसे फीवर आ रहा है तो यू हैव टू एड ऑन पैरासिटामोल. If the patient is having vomiting, if the patient is having pain, then you have to add maybe NSAID like acyclovir, or maybe if the patient is having vomiting, then pantoprazole. So any antiemetic and antacid that has to be added to the patient. So that is your supportive treatment. Which antibiotic is the drug of choice? That is commonly asked. If you want to know the drug of choice of any drug, any disease, you should know what is the most common organism which is causing it. The most common organism which is causing tonsillitis is upper respiratory tract. I don't even have to tell you. Upper respiratory tract is Streptococcus. Yes, it is Streptococcus. Which type of Streptococcus? Beta hemolytic Streptococcus. Drug of choice for this kind of Streptococcus is, it is amoxicillin with clavulanic acid, or sometimes if the patient is not able to tolerate, maybe third generation cephalosporins or macrolides can be added. But the drug of choice will be amoxicillin and clavulinate, right? So that is the drug of choice for beta hemolytic streptococci. Sometimes it is also viral infection. Viruses like respiratory syncytial virus or influenza virus are common to cause upper respiratory tract infections. But here we are talking about purulent tonsillitis, and that is commonly caused by the bacteria, right? For the chronic tonsillitis, what is the treatment? The treatment is surgery. What surgery? It is tonsillectomy, right? And one quick revision. We saw the different layers of pharyngeal wall. Remember, mucosa, submucosa, pharyngobasilar fascia, muscle, that is the constrictor muscle, and the bucopharyngeal fascia. Where is the tonsil? Where is the tonsil? The tonsil is in the submucosal layer. It is a lymphoid organ in the lamina propria of the submucosa. So when you have to remove the tonsil, you are going to remove it from the just in front of the pharyngobasilar fascia. You will not go into the details of or into the depth of pharyngobasilar fascia, because there you will get the muscle, and muscle is going to bleed. We are not going to do details of tonsillectomy over here. That is another surgical video we will share with you a little later. But what you need to know about tonsils, a little bit more you need to know about the tonsil. We are just going to see here a little 2 minutes more about the tonsil before we close this video, right? Number one, This is the uvula, right? And the soft palate, the palatoglossus fold. Behind this is the palatopharyngeous fold. The palatopharyngeous fold. In between is the tonsil. Now, if this is how I draw the tonsil, then this is a layman diagram. As a ENT student, I would not prefer this kind of diagram. What will I prefer a diagram as? I will prefer a diagram like this. Yes, this is the correct diagram of the tonsil. Yes, so this is the right diagram. Why have I drawn this diagram yahan pe is tarike se irregular? Remember, where does tonsil come out from? Tonsil develops from the second pharyngeal pouch, from the second pharyngeal pouch, right? And these are the ye jo second pharyngeal pouch ke remnants hai, uski wajah se iski jo mucosa hai wo irregular hai, wo usko khichta hai andar. So this forms small fossa or bursa kind of thing. We commonly call this areas as crypts, right? So if this is the tonsil, these are multiple crypts over it, right? And the biggest crypt is called as crypta magna. It is the crypta magna, and this crypta magna is the actual site exactly where the second pharyngeal pouch remnant is, right? So ye crypts hain. Is crypt ki wajah se kya cheeze ho rahi hain? एक चीज तो ये हो रही है कि हमारा कई बार जो हम खाना खाते हैं, अगर हम प्रॉपरली उसको चबाते नहीं है, इफ यू डोंट च्यू द फूड प्रॉपरली, इट गेट्स लॉस्ट ओवर हियर, एंड दैट काइंड ऑफ सिचुएशन कैन गिव राइज टू स्मॉल 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 स्टोन्स हियर, एंड वी कॉल दीज स्टोन्स एज टॉन्सिलोलिथ. वी कॉल दिम एज टॉन्सिलोलिथ, विच कैन कॉज पेन टू द पेशेंट, विच कैन कॉज हैलिटोसिस टू द पेशेंट. उसकी मुंह से बदबू आ सकती है. And secondly, because it stays for the long time, यहाँ पे pus develop हो सकता है, bacteria lodgement हो सकते हैं, and when we press on this tonsil, this cheesy material will come out, and that is what we call this as the Irvine-Moore sign. So, right? So, crypt के बारे में हमने ये समझा अभी. Now, what is there lateral to the crypt? We call this area as the tonsillar bed. We call this area as the tonsillar bed. तो अब ये tonsillar fossa को हम थोड़ा सा समझ लेते हैं. ये था हमारा एंटीरियर पिलर, राइट? दिस इज अवर पोस्टीरियर पिलर. कैन यू सी दिस ट्राइंगुलर फोसा विच इज देयर इन फ्रंट ऑफ अबव द टॉन्सिल? दिस ट्राइंगुलर फोसा, ये खाली जगह है. सो इफ दिस इज एन एंटीरियर पिलर, दिस इज अ पोस्टीरियर पिलर, एंड इन बिटवीन देयर इज टॉन्सिल. सो दिस ट्राइंगुलर फोसा अबव दिस टॉन्सिल, दिस इज कॉल्ड एज प्लाइका ट्राइंगुलरिस. प्लाइका ट्राइंगुलरिस, or sometimes also if it is semilunar, then some people call it as plica semilunaris, but commonly called as plica triangularis. And jo piche hai tonsil ke, that is the tonsillar bed. What forms the tonsillar bed? Again the same thing, the same layers of the mucosa, right? So mucosa to hamari yahan aage hai tonsil ke. So there is a mucosa which is in front of the tonsil. The submucosa is having the tonsil within it. So this is the tonsil, right? So this is the tonsil in the submucosa, the lymphoid tissue in the submucosa. Then behind this will be the pharyngobasilar fascia. Which fascia? Pharyngobasilar fascia. Behind that will be the muscles, the constrictor muscles of the pharynx. Which constrictor muscle of the pharynx? Remember, superior constrictor, middle constrictor, inferior constrictor. Three constrictor muscles. You remember, superior constrictor was taking its origin from the from the base of the skull and the mandible. Middle constrictor was taking its origin from the hyoid. Inferior constrictor was taking its origin from the laryngeal and the cricoid cartilage. So, where is hyoid? Hyoid is below the tonsil. Agar ye hamare tonsil hai, hyoid niche hai. So that means middle constrictor is below the tonsillar level. Middle constrictor is below the tonsil. So which muscle is forming the bed of the tonsil? The superior constrictor. Which muscle? Superior constrictor, right? And behind the superior constrictor is the next fascia, that is the buccopharyngeal fascia. So these are forming the bed of the tonsil. Within the bed of the tonsil are your arteries and the veins of the tonsil. So I'm going to just draw the neurovascular bundle. Outside this will be your styloid process and the parapharyngeal space, right? So this is the neurovascular bundle which is there within the tonsil, the tonsillar arteries and tonsillar vein. Which all arteries give branch to the tonsil? The palatine branch from the tonsil, both palatine arteries, the ascending palatine artery and the descending palatine artery. The ascending palatine artery is a branch of the facial, whereas the descending palatine artery is the branch of the maxillary artery, both coming from the external carotid, right? Then the ascending pharyngeal artery, that also gives branch to the tonsil, and the lingual artery. So all these arteries give branch to the lingual artery. Once, I don't remember the year, but there was a question which is the main blood supply of the tonsil. If you are asked the main blood supply of the tonsil, then you will say it is the ascending palatine artery, right? So that is what we have to understand. If we have to remove the tonsil, we are going to remove tonsil at which level? We are going to remove the tonsil at the level of the buccopharyngeal fascia, at the level of the pharyngobasilar fascia, because beyond this is the muscle which has all the vessels and is going to cause lot of hemorrhage, right? So have you understood the anatomy of the tonsil? Have you understood the acute tonsillitis and the chronic tonsillitis differences? Do you remember now which is the most common bacteria that is causing tonsillitis? It is beta hemolytic streptococcus, and because it is a gram positive cocci, the drug of choice will be amoxicillin group of drug, the penicillin group of drug, and the commonly the drug that we give is amoxicillin and clavulinate combination, right? And then just let us go through the slides once again so that you have that picture memory in your mind. What is the Paradise criteria? More than 7 infections in 1 year, right? Or lot the 3 cardinal signs. What are the 3 cardinal signs? The flushed anterior pillar, Erwin-Mohr sign, and the jugulodigastric lymph nodes. Erwin-Mohr sign, what was it? When you press on the tonsil, the cheesy material comes out from the crypts of the tonsil. Another quick revision, acute tonsillitis, drug of choice, beta hemolytic streptococci, so penicillin group of drug. Zenker's diverticulum, I'm sure you all will be able to answer a question on Zenker's diverticulum for this, right? So now we know what are the important diseases from the hypopharynx, the pharyngeal wall, that is the Zenker's diverticulum, and the tonsil, the oropharynx, that is your acute and chronic tonsillitis, right? You will all be able to answer all the questions based on this. You all will be able to answer the Viva questions based on this. Yes, you will be. So now I'm going to stop here for this lecture. We have one more lecture on diseases of pharynx. We are going to cover the diseases of nasopharynx. What are the 2 important diseases of nasopharynx? The nasopharyngeal angiofibroma and nasopharyngeal carcinoma. So it's again going to be a fun-filled class and very, very conceptual. So stay with me for the next lecture. Thank you.